people to know there's some brains beneath the wig and a heart beneath the boobs. And I think people are beginning to see that.
Mm-hmm.
I think I could get away with less, but I like more.
Can we talk about some of your leading ladies?
Sure.
I made a list of them, and not even all of them, but it is quite a list. Lana Turner, Hedy Lamarr, June Allison, Margaret Sullivan, Judy Garland, Grace Kelly, Raquel Welch. Were you ever in love with any of them?
What? In love with all of them?
I don't know exactly why, but Dolly Parton and I hit it off right from the start. I was crazy about her. Still am. I did two interviews with her. The first was with Dolly, the country music star. The second was with Dolly, the superstar. If any performer ever knew where she was going and how best to get there, it was Dolly. I think you'll get a kick out of seeing her tour bus in the first interview and that Tennessee mansion in the second. Dolly told me that she wanted people to see the brain beneath the wig and the heart beneath the boobs. Stick around and you will. In a moment, Dolly Parton.
Lifetime's making waves. Win the ride of a lifetime. Grand prize, the 17th seat on the America Cube. Plus, a brand new Chevy Cavalier. First prize, a four-night cruise to the Bahamas on the Big Red Boat. Second prize, 120 minutes of prepaid domestic long-distance calling from MCI. Send a postcard with your name, age, address, and phone number to this address to be received by February 7th, 1995. The seat, the car, the cruise, or the calls, win the ride of a lifetime. Sponsored by the Big Red Boat, America's number one family cruise and vacation.
We give our dogs pedigree as a source of meat in their diet.
When you open a can of Choice Cuts, there's big meaty chunks and a rich brown gravy. You can really smell the meatiness. For my money, pedigree is the best dog food you can buy.
Pedigree, developed with vets, recommended by top breeders.
Truth is, cellular phones look a lot alike. Fact is, they're not. Often imitated, never duplicated. The one and only Motorola Flip Cellular Phone. The more you need a cellular phone, the more you need Motorola.
Moms know how much kids love great-tasting Flintstones, and they choose it nearly 3-to-1 over any other brand. Flintstones, all the vitamins and minerals kids need.
Rocking the boat. Women race for the America's Cup. Only on Lifetime. Television for women.
You come again.
With her wild wigs and outrageous figure, Dolly Parton may be a country music caricature, but it's of her own design. Behind it all is a savvy businesswoman and a prolific songwriter. From rags to rhinestones, Dolly Parton's story is an American fairy tale. Born in 1946, Dolly Rebecca Parton was the fourth of 12 children and grew up in the Smoky Mountains of Tennessee. Home was a four-room house with no electricity and no indoor plumbing. After graduating from high school in 1964, Dolly headed for Nashville, and she got her first break with Porter Wagoner, a well-established country performer.
Daddy was an old-time preacher man.
They were a successful duet, but Dolly decided to go solo in 1974.
I can see the light of a brand new day. I can see.
It didn't take long for country audiences to fall in love with Dolly's tunes and heartfelt lyrics.
Oh, and everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right.
Since 1966, Dolly has been married to building contractor Carl Dean, who prefers the shadow of his wife's spotlight. For most of their time together, they've called this mansion outside Nashville home. When we first spoke in 1977, Dolly was on tour, traveling around the country in her custom-designed bus.
Can we see your room?
Yeah. Okay, now this is my couch also. This is my bed. And this lets down from, you know, from pulling down. There's a piece in the back and it makes a full bed. It comes all the way out to the wall, so I have lots of room to sleep. And then up here in these cabinets are my wigs. So here's another Dolly and another one and another one. And So that makes it really nice for me. It keeps it pretty nice. Actually, I have three closets in this room, but this one is the most special because this holds all of my stage clothes. And all of these clothes are hand washable. I just put them in the sink in a motel room. I just rinse them out. They're wrinkle-free. I don't have to iron them because that works out really good for me. And so it saves a lot of cleaning bill and, you know, it works.
I remember Dolly was so pretty and easygoing, and that her genuinely kind nature came through in her music.
So with patches on the breeches and holes in both the shoes, in my coat of many colors, well, I hurried off to school just to find the others laughing and making fun of me and my coat of many colors Mama made. Me. They didn't understand it, and I tried to make them see that one is only poor, only if they choose to be. It is true we had no money, but I was rich as I could be in my coat of many colors Mama made for me, made just for me.
Tell me about your childhood.
Well, there's really quite a bit to tell. I don't know how far back you want to start.
Well, let's start at the beginning.
Okay. I was born in a little log cabin, yeah, on the banks of the Little Pigeon River. And, of course, at that time, we only had three other children. There's 12 children. There's eight younger than me.
Dolly, where I come from, would I have called you a hillbilly?
If you had of, it would have been something very natural, but I would have probably kicked your shins or something. No, actually.
But when I think of hillbillies, am I thinking of your kind of people?
I think you probably are. The people that grew up where I was were the ones that you would consider the little Abner people, Daisy May, and that sort of thing. They took that kind of thing from people like us, but we were very proud people, people with a lot of class. It was country class, but it was a great deal of class, and most of my people were not that educated, but they are very, very intelligent. Good common sense, horse sense, we called it.
Dolly, you said, and maybe you were talking about when you were a kid, you said, I felt that I never belonged. I felt I was always different.
I wanted more than to just be a farmer's daughter, even though I'm proud to be. I just wanted pretty things. I wanted money to buy the things that I had always been impressed with as a child. I wanted to be a star.
Dolly, did you look like this when you were a kid?
Not quite.
I mean, you didn't have the blonde wig, but when you went into school, when you were 11, 12, 13, was it this about you?
Well, you mean the full figure?
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yeah, I thought that's what you meant. Well, actually, I've always been pretty well blessed. As a child, I grew up fast. Other members of my family, you know, have done the same.
You're very beautiful. You don't have to wear the blonde wigs. You don't have to wear the extreme clothes, right?
No, it's certainly a choice. I don't like to be like everybody else. I've often made this statement that I would never stoop so low as to be fashionable. That's the easiest thing in the world to do. I'm very real where it counts, and that's inside, and as far as my outlook on life and the way I care about people and the way I care about myself and the things that I care about. But I just chose to do this, and it's show business is a money-making joke, and I just always like telling jokes, you know.
But do you ever feel that you're a joke, that people make fun of you?
Oh, I know they make fun of me. But actually, all these years, the people, you know, have thought the joke was on me, but it's actually been on the public. I know exactly what I'm doing, and I can change it at any time. I make more jokes about myself than anybody. Because I enjoy, I know, like I say, I am sure of myself as a person. I'm sure of my talent. And to me, and I'm sure of my love and for life and that sort of thing, I'm very content. I like the kind of person that I am. So I can afford to piddle around and doodiddle around with makeups and clothes and stuff because I am secure with myself.
Listen, tell me about this marriage of yours, this man whom nobody ever seems to see. We heard that he was here. We heard that he was in town, but none of us have seen him. Paul Dean, You don't see him very much. You're on the road most of the time. You've said, I know that this marriage will always last. This man gives me everything I need. How do you know?
We have our foundation. We have our roots. We have all the things that everybody's looking for, and that's happiness in a marriage.
Well, what about when you're on the road, weeks at a time? No temptations?
Well, I didn't say that we never had temptations.
But when you have these temptations, does anything happen that he could be jealous of?
No, not really, because he's the kind of person, and I'm the kind of person, that if, by being apart, if we should meet somebody, I would never tell him. He would never know, and it wouldn't hurt him. And it's the same way with him. I wouldn't want to know it. As long as he loves me, and as long as he's good to me, and as long as we're good to each other, I don't think that it happens. But I'm just saying, I wouldn't want to pry in it. I've got better things to do than to sit around in my room thinking, oh, what's Carl doing tonight? I wonder if he's with somebody and this and that.
I don't know too much about country music. But what I did know about you before we met was that you'd started and still are with the Grand Ole Opry. That you'd been with a very prominent country music singer named Porter Wagner for 6 years. You worked with your family, had the whole band together. And then in the last year, goodbye Porter Wagner, a Hollywood, new Hollywood agent, goodbye to the family band, and I hear the folks back home saying, she's gone Hollywood, Dolly's changed, or Dolly might change, not that she's changed yet. Tell us about all that.
Well, actually, I think a lot of what I'm doing musically has been distorted quite a bit with so much press, you know, and dwelling on the same thing. I'm not making a crossover from country to pop. I'm trying to be accepted in the pop field as well as the country field. I feel my music is its own music, just like I'm my own person. I mean, I write them, I sing them, I have my own way of singing them, my own way of doing it. And as a business person, I like to think that there's more money to be made than the money I've been making. I've been working too hard, too long for too little.
Okay, so a wider audience, more of a pop audience.
I want to be able to walk in any place and say, well, that's Dolly Parton.
And be known everywhere.
Be known by the people. There's Dolly. She's, you know, she's got good songs, and, you know, or she's different, or this and that.
As a rock star?
Well, I want to be a star, a universal star.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to be a superstar. I guess all people dream of that. So in order to be a superstar, you can't be just a superstar in one area. That means you have to appeal to a majority of people. And that's what I'm trying to do.
Dolly, you've said of yourself that you live a lot in your own imagination. Sometimes you remind yourself of a fairy tale. So I want to try a fairy tale on you. Once upon a time, there was a little girl. Her name was Dolly Parton, and
she lived in a small town in the mountains, which she loved because it was a comfort, because she knew there was love and security there in her family. But she was a child very curious, and she wanted all the things that she had always been impressed with, like the fairy tales of the Mother Goose stories and the Cinderellas and the lost slipper. Well, I guess she kind of wanted to find the other slipper in sort of a way, so she worked hard and she dreamed a lot. And one day, it came true. She was a fairy princess, and she lived happily ever after.
Next, Dolly Parton goes Hollywood and dreams of Dollywood.
He's a stranger in a small town. The perfect place to find romance and pull off the perfect crime. He didn't plan on her.
Get in.
But she definitely has plans for him. And now he has to choose between the woman he loves and the woman who keeps his secret.
Wasn't that lucky I saw you there the other day at the bar?
Don Johnson, Virginia Madsen, The Hot Spot.
Tonight at 9 p.m., 8 Central, here on Lifetime.
Dear Tylenol, thank you for inventing a medicine that doesn't taste like one.
Matthew no longer cries, screams, and hides when it's time to take it.
Nothing compares to your new bubblegum flavor.
Moms tell us relieving fevers has never been easier. Thanks to Children's Tylenol Bubblegum Suspension, its unique formula coats the medicine with a richer, thicker taste, so it's easier for kids to take, and it's easier on their parents, too. Children's Tylenol Suspension, the first choice of pediatricians.
One minute I'm hot for Patrick, and then the next minute I'm the mother
of 7 sons.
In the best of families.
You can't be telling me there's nothing I can do. I got a son over there.
The tears may flow.
It's my fault. He's dead.
Finding somebody to blame isn't going to make him safe.
But the laughter runs deep. And the love is forever.
I just don't think I can live without you.
Susan Sarandon, Safe Passage, rated PG-13. Now playing.
Thank you.
Truth is, cellular phones look a lot alike. Fact is, they're not. Often imitated, never duplicated. The one and only Motorola Flip Cellular Phone. The more you need a cellular phone, the more you need Motorola.
Sprint would like to demonstrate what happens when you take away the limitations of time and space. Introducing Sprint Worldwide, the first international calling plan that is truly global, with a 20% savings on anyone, anytime, anywhere you call, in America and across the world, forever.
Sprint Worldwide.
Hey, I'm walking here.
Save nearly $400 a year. It's the best plan in the world.
I see you in a bulky diaper that just might leak. But I see something better. Love's Ultra Leak Guards, nearly 50% thinner and still great at stopping leaks.
Look, upside down. This super absorbent leak guard layer soaks up wetness faster.
So I see you, and I don't see leaks. And wait till Mommy sees our nice low price. Love's Ultra Leak Guards. Say hello, Dan. Bye-bye, leaks.
Islands in the stream, that is what we are, no one in between.
Though her roots are in country music, by the 1980s, Dolly Parton had become a pop superstar.
And we rely on children.
Ben Hollywood put out the welcome mat for this country girl. Her film debut in 9 to 5 was a huge hit.
Working 9 to 5.
The title song became a workaday anthem, and her acting was sassy and sweet.
Use your mind and they never give you credit.
Dolly's sexy sincerity came across in later films, including Rhinestone, Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, Straight Talk, and Steel Magnolias. She wrote and recorded this song. Whitney Houston's dramatic 1993 rendition firmly established I Will Always Love You as one of the most popular love songs. And as if staggering success in both movies and music weren't enough, she opened Dollywood in 1986, her very own theme park in eastern Tennessee. And she's now an author with the 1994 release of a tell-all autobiography. My second interview with Dolly Parton was in 1982. At the time, Dolly was recovering from an illness at her home in Tennessee.
Can we see the house?
I'd love to show you.
Okay, good.
This house, she said, is where she comes not to let her hair down, but to take it off.
Well, actually, this is quite a bit different than the old house, but it's a place you're welcome. It's only a mansion on the hill.
The living room, she told us, reminds her of what she thought elegance was when she was a little girl. The oversized master bedroom is a sanctuary for Dolly and her husband, Carl. There are two full-sized rooms just for Dolly's clothes, hundreds of wigs, and thousands of pairs of shoes. When she's home, the music room is where Dolly spends most of her time. Here she writes and sings the songs that seem to come straight from her heart. She even convinced me to sing along with her.
Repeat after me, just whatever I say, you say. He said if I be lifted up,
be lifted up.
He said if I be lifted up. What did he say?
He said if I.
He said if I
be lifted up,
be lifted up. I'll draw men under me. Ladies and gentlemen, a first.
And they last.
And they last, I'm sure. But I thought we was good.
Dolly, you had a lot of time to think about yourself. Are you different? Have you changed? Has anything changed?
I really have thought, well, I must take better care of myself. You know, I've worked hard and I had a lot of dreams. I've worked not only for myself, but for other people. And it's like now I want to enjoy, really enjoy the more simple things rather than just going full blast.
Are you a star now?
Yeah, I think I'm a star. But As far as what people call a star.
You call a star? What you wanted for you?
What I call a star, for me, the Dolly Parton star, is accomplishing every possible thing that I can. I want to mean something. I don't want to just be some joke. I don't want to be the all-American joke, you know, just with the boobs and the hair and the tight belts or the whatever. I want to be a meaningful, artistic, you know, person.
Okay. Yet you've got you said it, the boobs and the hair and the tight belt.
Mm-hmm.
Now, can you give that up?
Like I said, I think to you before, I want people to know there's some brains beneath the wig and a heart beneath the boobs. And I think people are beginning to see that. I can get away with now, if I chose to change my look,
mm-hmm.
I think I could get away with less.
Yeah.
But I like more. So maybe I'll go the other way.
Your career's in a good place.
It is in a good place, and I'm in a good place now. But also I want to get in areas of business. I have a big dream of building a center or a city or being involved in a place in East Tennessee, my hometown up in Gatlinburg, which is one of the most wonderful places in the world, called Dollywood, USA. And this would be like a fantasy city, sort of like Disneyland, but like where it's like a mountain Disneyland, like a Smoky Mountain fairyland.
I want to talk about Carl. The mystery man.
Oh, yeah?
Your husband, Carl. Right.
Who?
Who? First of all, I never knew he was that attractive, since he never lets anybody see him except you. And he's a very tall, good-looking man.
He's very good.
And I understand you wanted him to be in the pictures, and he wouldn't.
I usually don't. I don't even ask him to do those things anymore after so many years. I said, but if you was ever going to do it, or if I was going to ever really ask you for a favor to do it, would you just let them shoot you and me? Maybe I can get on the tractor with you, or maybe I can come out while you're working on a truck. He said, hell no. I told you 10 years ago not to ask me to do that stuff. So he said, I just don't want to go to the hardware. I don't want to go to the co-op. I don't want to go all places I go. And people say, I know you. I saw you on that Barbara Walters show. So it had nothing to do with you, but yes, he's gone, and yes, he is good looking, and yes, I do love him, and he does exist.
This is the longest you've been home for a long time. Did it make a difference in the marriage?
Yeah, that busted it up.
Did it really?
No, but it is very hard, you know, because he's very independent. He's working with his brother and building a house, and he likes to do his own things. But I'm glad to be gone. He's glad for me to be gone, and so we're glad to get back to being abnormal.
Yeah, it is abnormal. I mean, what about the little woman
people
and the togetherness? Yeah.
Well, it's a new day, Barbara.
Yeah. Oh, I guess you've said that you can't imagine ever leaving Carl, ever having a breakup. What does it give you, this marriage?
Well, it gives me everything that a person needs in a marriage or in a relationship. It gives me freedom, which is something I feel you must have being creative. But it
but
also
then you don't
gives
have to get
me
married if you want freedom.
Well, that's true, but this is a very special kind of sacred freedom. I'm there for him, he's there for me. If he needs me at any time, I would come, no matter where I'm at or what I'm doing, I would drop it, and the same with him. But it's somebody to plan with, somebody to grow old with, somebody to have fun with. We have a lot in common. We're good friends. I just know that there's not another person in this world that could give me all those things that I've grown up with, that I've been with so many years, so why would I? There may be some people that might turn my head a time or two,
yeah,
and have, but that don't mean that they could take Carl's place.
What happens if someone turns your head?
Well, it depends.
Yeah.
I think it's true with you or true with anybody. I mean, I'm always seeing people that I'm attracted to. I mean, I'm no liar. I'm certainly no fool. And like I say, I'm married, but I ain't dead. But that don't mean I have to go, you know.
Are you faithful?
Well, as best I know how.
What does that mean?
I'm a flirt. But my husband's a flirt. But he knows I'm a flirt. I know he's a flirt. And it's not a threat to us. I just love people. And they're, like I say, and as much as I'm out in the world and being a woman away from home, there are these good-looking guys that, you know, that come on to you pretty strong. And every now and then, I like to come on a little strong myself.
And?
And I do. But it's all in a flirt. But I know that I've got something at home that I wouldn't threaten nor take a chance on losing for anything in the world. No different than anybody else. It's just that I'm telling the truth and a lot of people would deny it.
Has success hurt the marriage?
Not a bit. I think it's helped it.
Has
but
your having more money hurt the marriage?
No, because my husband makes good money. He's not one of those. It's not a matter of my money or his money. Right. It's our money.
You've not regretted having children, not having children?
No. It's either a career or the children, and I've never been able to have children, actually. It's not that I've spent years trying not to have them. It's just that I never did, but I never missed it. My husband doesn't want children either, or he certainly hasn't missed the fact that we don't have them. So I guess everybody has their own purpose in life, and I'm trying my best to fulfill what I think mine is.
Dolly, one of the things that's very sweet to see when someone comes here to your house is your relationship with your sisters. One sister is your makeup artist. Another sister is your assistant secretary.
Well, we're very close. My sister Cassie is a makeup artist here in town, and so I asked her if she would do my makeup today. My sister Willardine is a gifted writer. She's written a book about the family called In the Shadow of a Song, but she also helps me when I'm in town. She does it more out of loyalty and love than the fact that she's just working for me. So we're all very devoted to each other. I do for them, they do for me.
You, more than anyone I know, practically always had goals. You're going to do this in 5 years, you're going to do this in 7 years, you're going to do this in... How do you think you're going to be remembered, let's say, 100 years from now?
Remembered? Well, I think probably what I'd like people to say about me 100 years from now is, boy, she looks great for her age.
In 1986, Dolly finally opened that theme park she talked of so often. Dollywood, set in her hometown of Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, is a huge success. Thinking back on it now, everything she said she wanted in those interviews, she got. In fact, I can only recall one devastating failure. No matter how hard she tried, she couldn't make a country singer out of me. In a moment, my interview with Jimmy Stewart.
Is pure magic.
Here is a song.
He sold more than 100 million records around the world. Engelbert Humperdinck.
There goes my reason for living.
Now, Heartland Music presents the one and only Engelbert Humperdinck in a special collection of his best loved hits. All his unforgettable songs.
Two lonely people together.
All your Engelbert favorites.
Please release me, let me go.
No one sings a love song like Engelbert.
Two different worlds. We live in two different worlds.
There's a kind.
All the songs you love.
All over the world.
Two beautiful albums.
Tonight you're just too good to be true.
But remember,
can't take my
this special
eyes
collection is not in stores.
So I sing you to sleep after the loving with a song.
Please stay tuned to order the best of Engelbert now.
The shadow of your smile.
Call 1-800-292-5900 to save all COD charges and pay only $12.98 for records or cassettes or $16.98 for CD plus $3 shipping. Use your credit card or send check or money order to Engelbert, P.O. Box 95519, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Remember, save COD charges by sending check or money order or use your credit card.
Lifetime's daytime hit, Our Home, weekdays at 10 and 2, only on Lifetime.
Helmer James here with my grandson Lance talking about the big sale at Orange Park Discount Furniture. Every bedroom suite is on sale at 33% off the regular price. And brighten up your home with this colorful soap and love seat for only $5.99. Also, you get 12 months interest-free financing. That's Orange Park Discount Furniture, Highway 17. Call us at 264-5464.
What you're about to hear may make an incredible difference in your life. At St. John's River Community College, you'll find an ideal learning environment close to home with small classes and superior instructors that are student-friendly. Whether your goal is transferring to a state university, preparing for a high-paying career, or enhancing your current job skills, St. John's River Community College is the place.
I rode an elephant with Jimmy Stewart. And how many people can say that? Actually, it was his adopted elephant. He loved all sorts of animals, including a 6-foot-tall, invisible rabbit named Harvey. Harvey, by the way, paid a rare visit to the interview, which I believe is one of our most poignant. The only thing better than a day at the zoo is a day at the zoo with Jimmy Stewart. In 1983, under a sunny California sky, I had the privilege of accompanying Jimmy Stewart and his now late wife, Gloria, to the Los Angeles Zoo, where they were major contributors. Over the years, Stewart himself has been a spokesman for the preservation of wildlife. You and your wife sponsored different animals here at the zoo.
Yes, I have an orangutan, and then I think last year at the zoo ball that they had where they auction off animals, I thought I was getting another orangutan, but I got a plum bird toad.
A toad? And this, if you'll forgive me, is your grandchild?
Yeah, sort of. 10 years ago, I adopted Gail. She's right over there. And this is her daughter. It's about 4.5 months old.
Very sweet.
Yeah,
she's going to eat your jacket. You don't mind that, Grandpa,
do you? No, not for Grandpa.
The Stewart sponsored many animals at the zoo, including a fraction of a pachyderm. So, you own part of an elephant?
Yeah, we adopted half an elephant.
I have to ask you what everybody asked you, right? Which half?
We split it down the center. Barbara, would you like to ride an elephant?
I think it would be wonderful. Why do you have to see a pal?
No, not him, but I know one that is just great, and it's not very far from here. But would you like to ride one?
I'd like to look it over. I'd like to look over the half that's going to be mine. Hang on. I don't like this.
No, you just have to get used to it.
How long does it take me before I get used to it?
You'll be used to it when you pull up to the thing and get off.
Thank you. I'm holding on so tight, my hands are turning blue.
He has kind of a nice gait, doesn't he?
No.
No?
I thought I was doing an interview with a distinguished thespian. I didn't think I was going to end up riding an elephant. The distinguished thespian made an incredible 28 movies in just his first 6 years in Hollywood. From his early collaborations with Frank Capra, including Mr. Smith Goes to Washington and It's a Wonderful Life, to the thrillers he made with Hitchcock, like Rear Window, Jimmy Stewart was a favorite of directors and audiences alike. He brought a sense of believability to even the most unbelievable plots. Far from just a leading man, he did it all, including dramas like Anatomy of a Murder, and who could forget his relationship with that imaginary rabbit in Harvey. And then there was The Philadelphia Story, for which Stewart won his only Best Actor Academy Award. A staunch conservative, Stewart also starred in many military films, like Strategic Air Command. He was rough and tough, shooting it up in westerns like John Ford's The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, and he was equally adept in comedies, such as Mr. Hobbs Takes a Vacation. Stewart even managed to combine these talents in the Western comedy, The Cheyenne Social Club, in which he paired up with his longtime friend, Henry Fonda. Whatever the story, Stewart consistently brought a sense of the everyman to his work. In fact, he told me himself that he considered the audience to be not only customers, but partners. His typical American characters, boyish, honest, and kind, mirror the real life of Jimmy Stewart. Stewart hit Hollywood with all the homespun decency he had grown up with as a boy. He was born in Indiana, Pennsylvania, the small town which honored their most famous citizen on his 75th birthday in 1983. Stewart had a near-perfect childhood. His parents even called their home the Garden of Eden. He had two younger sisters and a wonderful close relationship with his father. Mr. Stewart, like his father before him, ran Stewart's Hardware on Main Street. Jimmy might have stayed in the family business, but instead he went off to study architecture at Princeton, his father's alma mater. In 1932, Jimmy played in his first summer stock and got hooked on acting. After graduating, he went to New York to room with his friend, Henry Fonda, and pursue work in theater. He made his first feature film in 1935, but his movie career was interrupted by World War II. Stewart served in the Air Corps and later rose to Brigadier General, the highest ranking actor in military history. He came home from the war to a proud family. His father had served in two wars, and the Stewart family for generations had a strong military commitment. Stewart remained active in the Air Force Reserves until he was 60 years old. Then he resumed his acting career, and 4 years later, Hollywood's most eligible bachelor met and married Gloria Hattrick. He was already 41. They had four children, two sons from Gloria's first marriage and twin daughters. When I spoke with the Stewarts in 1983, they were living in Beverly Hills in the same home they bought just after they were married. Gloria Stewart was Jimmy's biggest fan and knew him better than anyone.
This is my big chance to ask you, what is Jimmy Stewart really like?
Well, he's honest. What you see is what you get.
When Gloria died from cancer in February of 1994, it marked the end of a true Hollywood love story. Theirs was a partnership spanning 44 years, and while he continues to suffer from health problems of his own, it is also a broken heart that troubles Jimmy Stewart these days. But when we spoke, Jimmy was lively, warm, and, well, normal. Just what I expected from everyone's favorite everyman.
Your life has seemed to be really such a good life. Most things have gone very, very well for you, haven't they? It's really been a sweet life.
Just, as I say, it's been a wonderful life from a picture of the same name.
No one can sit down to do an interview with Jimmy Stewart without asking about the way you talk. I mean, we are all so used now to Rich Little doing Jimmy Stewart. Can Jimmy Stewart do Rich Little doing Jimmy Stewart? I mean, we've been walking around for days now, all of us in the crew going, whoa, 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 whoa. Can you do you?
I more or less, I suppose, yeah, I can.
That's it.
I suppose that's what Rich Little says. But I think I got over of the actual stuttering part of it. But there's a lot of it left, according to Rich.
You you've made 80 movies, and you have never had an acting lesson. And I read that you said to would-be actors, for heaven's sake, stay away from acting schools. That's it?
I'm not against acting schools, or the way I got my experience was to learn the craft by working at it. You worked at and did small parts and big pictures and big parts and little pictures, and in that way you learned your craft, but you did it not by sitting and listening to somebody lecture to you about the theory of acting and the theory of motivation and saying, all right, now come up here and be a porcupine, you know.
My favorite, Harvey. Do people ask you about Harvey?
Oh, all the time. Most of them are people that suddenly appear. Most of them are older type men. They edge up and say, is Harvey with you? And I said, no, he has a cold. He stayed home. And I said, well, the next time you see him, give him my regards. And he disappears.
And
it's happened hundreds of times.
Do you give Harvey his regards when you see him?
Absolutely.
Is Harvey here?
Harvey's upstairs.
Sleeping?
I don't know. He should be up. I saw him at breakfast, but he should be up. The dogs are upstairs, and he likes the dogs.
Will you give him my regard?
Well, Barbara, I sure will. Okay. And he'll be very flattered.
Okay. Maybe now we'll talk about some of the other films. Unless he comes down and interrupts us, and then
well,
we can just pull up a...
If he does, I'll introduce him to everybody.
And then in 1976, you made the Cheyenne Social Club with your dearest friend, Henry Fonda. Henry Fonda often talked about you and wrote about you as the man he felt the closest to, the man he trusted the most. And he didn't trust too many people. You must miss him very much.
Yes, I do. I do. There isn't a day go by that I don't think about him. He was a remarkable man. And his finest actor, I think. I don't know of anybody better. But it was a wonderful kind of friendship. Like, you know, we wouldn't see each other for 6 months, 8 months. And when we would, it's as if it was just over the weekend, and we'd seen each other Friday, and this was Monday, and there was no difference. No difference. Maybe he even had a new wife, but it just rolled along.
And you and Henry Fonda could not have been more different politically. How did you deal with that?
Well, we got into a big fight back in the Madison Square Hotel about it.
When you were kids, when you were young?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we, between us, we just said, well, that's ridiculous. Let's not argue anymore about it. Let's forget it. You go your way, I'll go mine, and forget about it. Don't talk politics. And for the next 45 years, we didn't.
When we talk about politics, during the time that your son was fighting in Vietnam, Henry Fonda's daughter, Jane, was opposing our policy in Vietnam. Was this anything that the two of you ever discussed, or it was just there and never mentioned?
Never mentioned.
It's a great test to a friendship that it can exist when there are such trying and such very personal.
No, we just realized that we realized that if we start yelling at each other about this, the thing would go out the window, and both of us, I feel, valued this friendship too much to let that happen.
Can we talk about some of your leading ladies?
Sure.
I made a list of them, and not even all of them, but it is quite a list. Jean Harlow, Joan Crawford, Katharine Hepburn, Marlena Dietrich, Ginger Rogers, Lana Turner, Hedy Lamarr, June Allison, Margaret Sullivan, Judy Garland, Grace Kelly, Raquel Welch. Were you ever in love with any of them?
Well, I'm in love with all of them. I never had the list read off like that. And I didn't realize,
tremendous.
But that is quite a list, isn't it? Ooh, yeah, I never thought, yeah.
Who was your
I
favorite?
I loved all of them.
You loved all of them? As long as the picture was being made, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody after the picture was being made?
Sure. Maggie Sullivan, I always loved her. Marlena Dietrich, because she's just great. Absolutely wonderful. And Grace Kelly.
And Ginger Rogers, too, I hear.
Ginger, yeah. Ginger, I took out a lot. We had a wonderful time.
Ever think of marrying any of them?
No, I really didn't. I, up until after the war, after I'd made maybe 10, 15, 20 pictures, I started feeling that I after all the work and after all the war interruption and everything, I started feeling maybe it's time I settled down. And then I just, it was good fortune for me. I just happened to meet this absolutely wonderful, beautiful, charming, humorous, great girl. And, you know, it was just this great good fortune that has come to me, it seems, all my life. This happened to me, and there I did it.
Next, Jimmy Stewart, the Patriot, on Love and War.
Lifetime's making waves. Win the ride of a lifetime. Grand prize, the 17th seat on the America Cube. Plus, a brand new Chevy Cavalier. First prize, a four-night cruise to the Bahamas on the Big Red Boat. Second prize, 120 minutes of prepaid domestic long-distance calling from MCI. Send a postcard with your name, age, address, and phone number to this address to be received by February 7th, 1995. The seat, the car, the cruise, or the calls, win the ride of a lifetime. Genuine Chevrolet, proud sponsor of America Cubed.
Look what Daddy can juggle with his Nokia cellular phone, a rubber duck, and a teddy bear. A Nokia cellular phone, a rubber duck, and a teddy bear. And with my Nokia cellular phone, I can juggle something even more amazing. My schedule.
One touch dialing makes a Nokia cellular phone easy to use.
Hello?
Amazing.
Nokia cellular phones.
Remember those great songs that really said something? Well, they're back!
Guitar band!
Heartland Music presents Wacky Favorites! 40 of the craziest, nuttiest, wacko hits ever!
And then the witch doctor, he told me what to do. He said that...
Songs filled with emotion.
On the bank of the river, stood running bare.
Songs with special memories.
Does your chewing gum lose its flavor? On the
40 classics.
Please, Mr. Custer, I don't want to go.
Don't talk back.
Whatever happened to my Transylvania twist?
It's now the match.
At last,
they played from all
the world's wackiest hits, captured forever. From pure insanity to disco fever.
Let's go, Mama. Everybody's chilling.
Remember,
when you're hot, you're hot.
No party is complete without wacky favorites.
Winchester Cathedral.
But this outrageous 40-song collection is not sold in stores.
They're coming to take me away, haha. They're coming
Please
to take
order
me away.
Now.
I want to get a job in a rock and roll band.
Operators are standing by.
Call 1-800-532-8484 to save all COD charges and pay only $19.98 for records or cassettes or $24.98 for two CDs plus $4 shipping. Use your credit card or send check or money order to Wacky Favorites, P.O. Box 95519, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Remember, save COD charges by sending check or money order or use your credit card.
Your childhood, when one hears you talk about your father, it just seems so sweet, and the kind of relationship that, I don't know, that old movies used to be made about, a father and son. What was he like, this father who adored you, who ran the hardware store and wanted you to be in it?
Oh, he's a very, very extra special man. I think about him every day. He's such a special, extra special man.
What stays with you when you say you think about him every day?
He went along with me. He was by my side instead of leading me and saying so and so. He was right by my side.
And still is?
All our lives together. And this is something it's meant so much to me in my life. I ended up in training, and I had a bomber squadron, and we were leaving for the war. And he and my mother came out to Sioux City, Iowa, and the last couple of days. And then we were leaving the next morning, and we went down to the hotel, and he couldn't really talk to me. He couldn't bring himself, but just as I was leaving and saying goodbye, he slipped a letter, an envelope in my pocket. And it was so beautiful and so loving and so, and did so much for me. And going into this thing, I don't know what was going to happen. But this was an encouraging thing. He was just saying, you're going into something terrible, dangerous and everything, but I just look to God and he's going to bring you through or something. I carried the letter in my pocket all through the war.
While we are talking about fathers and sons and wars, your son, you and Mrs. Stewart's son, Ronald, was killed in Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
You supported the war then.
Yes.
When your boy was killed, in the middle of that war that so many people opposed, did you ever feel that he died in vain, that he died for nothing?
No. Never, and I've never looked upon it as a tragedy. When he was called upon by his country, right or wrong, about the war, but when he was called upon, he didn't want them to draft him. He wanted to enlist. And when he got on the field of battle, he conducted himself in a gallant manner. And to me, that's not tragedy. And that's the way I feel about him all my life.
When people today talk about Jimmy Stewart as a legend, or when the Academy Award honors you, as it did, do you sort of pinch yourself and say, is that me? Is that that fellow who was, you know, was going to become an architectural student today? Me, a legend?
Well, but the legend thing, I don't know. But as far as pinching yourself, I pinch myself all the time. I feel it's this kind of a business that I'm in. It's this kind of a profession. It's what I thank God for it every day. It's exciting. And I think worthwhile. I think it's important.
And how would you like to be remembered?
How would I like to be remembered? I'd like people to remember me as someone that was good at his job and seemed to mean what he said.
I'm sure that's just how they'll remember you. I'd like to talk a lot more with you, but isn't that Harvey getting up and...
Oh, hey! Harvey, I've been talking to a very beautiful woman here, and I'd like you to meet her. This is Barbara Walters. Harvey, there it is. What? All right, well, I just wanted you to meet Barbara. Well, you can go back with the dogs. Okay.
He said goodbye, but he was nice.
Yeah. He's nice. I would sure miss him.
He's a stranger in a small town, the perfect place to find romance and pull off the perfect crime. He didn't plan on her.
Get in.
But she definitely has plans for him. And now he has to choose between the woman he loves and the woman who keeps his secret.
Wasn't that lucky I saw you there another day at the bar?
Don Johnson, Virginia Madsen, The Hot Spot. Tonight at 9 p.m., 8 Central, here on Lifetime.
Sometimes there's magic in a melody. Even without words, certain music touches the heart. Now, Instrumental Gold. 40 of the most memorable instrumental songs ever recorded. This is music made for dancing and romancing, or just listening and reminiscing. Instrumental Gold contains 40 original hits by the original artists. Bring back those tender memories. Treasury of 40 instrumental hits is not sold in any store. Instrumental Gold on 3 cassettes or 2 compact discs. Here's how to order.
Have your credit card ready and call toll-free 1-800-252-4111. Call from the U.S. or Canada. That's 1-800-252-4111. Or send $19.95 for 3 cassettes or $24.95 for 2 CDs. Plus $4 shipping to Instrumental Gold, P.O. Box 7400, Department V, Libertyville, Illinois, 60048.
Tomorrow at 10:30, only on Lifetime.
Think about Jimmy Stewart's life for a moment. A loving and lasting relationship with his wife, Gloria. Over 80 films, many of them classics. One of the most respected figures ever to work in Hollywood. As he said, it's been a wonderful life. From a picture of the same name.
Nobody gets the stars to talk like Barbara Walters. Next time, it's Joan Collins.
I like flirting. I'm a tremendous flirt. I know that. So therefore, I think that that comes across.
And Willie Nelson.
Most of the saddest songs that I've written have been at the saddest times in my life.
The stars, the surprises, and the moments you've never seen before. It's Barbara Walters, Interviews of a Lifetime. Next Friday night at 8.
A stranger in a small town, the perfect place to find romance and pull off the perfect crime. He didn't plan on her.
Well, get in.
But she definitely has plans for him. And now he has to choose between the woman he loves and the woman who keeps his secret.
Wasn't that lucky I saw you there the other day at the farm?
Don Johnson, Virginia Madsen, The Hot Spot.
Tonight at 9 p.m., 8 Central, here on Lifetime.